worship him. He is our prize, drawn to redemption by the grace in his eyes. If his grace is an ocean, we're all sinking. And so heaven meets earth like an awful sinking.
Go into the word. We ask that you please speak to us. Above all, give us ears to hear what you're saying and a heart to obey you. In Jesus' wonderful name, we pray. Amen. Praise God. Please turn your Bibles to Psalm 78. Psalm 78. I'll read 5 verses from verse 12. Psalm 78 from verse 12, the Bible says, I'll be reading from the New King James Version of the Bible. It says, marvelous things God did in the sight of their fathers, in the land of Egypt, in the field of Zoan. It says, God divided the sea and caused them to pass through. And he made the waters stand up like a heap. In the daytime also he led them with a cloud, and all the night with a light of fire. He split the rocks in the wilderness and gave them drinks in abundance, like the depths. He also brought streams out of the rock and caused waters to run down like rivers. He's simply talking about this incredible God we serve, this God that does things that are so awesome, we couldn't have thought about them before God did them. And that's the God we serve. If you want to give the short word a title this morning, it's Incredible God. Incredible God. It starts by saying marvelous things he did. It talks about how he divided the sea. They came, they were running from the army, Pharaoh's army. They had left Egypt. They were going on a journey that God had ordained for them. And they got to a point. There was a sea ahead of them. And Pharaoh's army closing in on them. Brethren, if you had asked all of them what they thought the way out was, not one of them could have imagined that God will divide the sea. It had never happened. But that's the God we serve. He's able to do for us more than we can ask, think, or imagine. It's unfortunate that a lot of the times when we go to God in prayer, we tell him how to do what we want him to do. That shows a lot of ignorance. I'm believing God that the way forward for us will be to ask God to show us what he wants to do. Because what you're telling God to do, a lot of the times isn't the way God wants to do it. They get to the Red Sea. As far as they're concerned, they're finished. They're wondering what can happen. I'm sure a lot of them will be praying that the Egyptian army will suddenly go mad and begin to kill each other. I mean, just ridiculous things. But God had a great plan. The Bible says he divided the sea, caused them to pass through on dry ground. He made the water stand like a heap. And then during the day, he led them with a cloud. At night, there was the fire. And he goes on to say, he split the rocks in the wilderness. There was a time, in fact, on two occasions in the Bible, the people were thirsty. And God provided water in the most unusual way. I mean, not any of them could ever have thought that water would come out of a rock. I mean, totally impossible. I was sharing with the church on Tuesday, and I said, they probably thought, because they had heard about how the flood came in the days of Noah, so they must have thought, maybe God is just going to send some torrential rainfall, and that is how our thirst will be quenched. But because God is God, and he has a penchant for showing off and causing others to know that he alone is God. You know, in Psalm 114, I'll read two verses, verses 7 and 8. Psalm 114, verse 7 says, tremble, O earth, at the presence of the Lord, at the presence of the God of Jacob, who turned the rock into a pool of water, the flint into a fountain of waters. You know, in our daily walk with God, a lot of the times we forget how awesome this God is. Let's look at the two accounts. I'll read real quick. Exodus 17. I'll read a few verses from Exodus 17. And the Bible says, then all the congregation of the children of Israel set out on their journey from the wilderness of Sin, according to the commandment of the Lord, and camped in Rephidim. But there was no water for the people to drink. Therefore, the people contended with Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. So Moses said to them, why do you contend with me? Why do you tempt the Lord? And the Lord thirsted, and the people thirsted there for water. And the people complained against Moses and said, why is it you have brought us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst? So Moses cried out to the Lord, saying, what shall I do with these people? Even Moses' prayer was not a sensible prayer. All due respect to Moses. He didn't say, Lord, how would you resolve this situation? Saying, God, what do we do? Do we kill these people? Or what? He says, they're almost ready to stone me. So should we stone them first, Lord? And the Lord said to Moses, go on before the people and take with you some of the elders of Israel. Also take in your hand your rod with which you struck the river and go. Behold, I will stand before you there on the rock in Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water will come out of it that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. Brethren, water came out of a rock. The second account is found in Numbers 20. I'll read from verse 8 to 11 because of time. It says, take the rod, and your brother Aaron, gather the congregation together, speak to the rock before their eyes, and it will yield its water. First time it says, strike the rock. Second time it says, speak. It will yield its water. Thus you shall bring water for them out of the rock, and give them drink, and give drink to the congregation and their animals. Moses took the rod from before the Lord as God commanded him. And Moses and Aaron gathered the assembly together before the rock. And he said to them, you know, now Moses had seen it happen before. So there was confidence. Instead of just doing what God said, he began to boast. He got into the flesh. Here now, you rebels. He's now calling his fellow. may God deliver us from pride. He says, here now, you rebels. Must we who, himself and God, have become one, must we bring water for you out of this rock? It says, then Moses lifted his hand and struck the rock twice with his rod, and water came out abundantly, and the congregation and the animals drank. Brethren, I'm believing that God will take someone into the realm of the miraculous, because that person is ready for what God wants to do. Psalm 78, I read two verses, tell us pretty much the same thing. Psalm 78, carrying on, we looked at these two verses. He split the rocks in the wilderness, gave them drink, like the depths, like an ocean. He also brought out, verses 15 and 16, he also brought streams out of the rock and caused waters to run down like rivers. And with all of that, these ungrateful people, let's read and understand their lack of gratitude, because sometimes we're like them. God does awesome things. Where every one of us is simply the grace and the mercy of God. That you can hear me is the mercy of God. That you can see me, the mercy of God. That you came to church safely, the mercy of God. But there are those that are still in their hearts grumbling and fighting God, grumbling against God and fighting God. My prayer is that this morning God will deliver you, deliver all of us in Jesus' name. Let's read verses 17 to 20, Psalm 78. The Bible says, after all that they saw great miracles, they sinned even more against God by rebelling against the Most High in the wilderness. And they tested God in their heart by asking for the food of their fancy. Yes, they spoke against God. They said, God, is it possible for you to prepare a table in the wilderness? Behold, he struck the rock so that the waters gushed out and the streams overflowed. He said, can he give bread as well? Can you imagine these people? Can he provide meat for his people? I mean, these were the first people that were looking for burgers. Wicked people. God supernaturally provided water. He said, God, water is not enough. You're a big God. Is it only water you can give? You can't give us bread. You can't give us meat. Although they asked for that at different times. To cut a long story short, God gave them manna. Brother, my prayer, let's just cut the sermon short. My prayer is that we will not be a people that lack gratitude. From verse 21, the Bible says, still in Psalm 78 from verse 21. It says, therefore the Lord heard this and was furious. So a fire was kindled against Jacob, and anger also came up against Israel. My prayer is that God won't be angry with us. Because they did not believe in God. How can you see water come out of a rock and feed a great number of people and their livestock and not just worship this God? You have the audacity, the effrontery to ask for bread and meat. And they did not trust in his salvation. Yet he had commanded the clouds above. They had seen and heard of great miracles and testimonies and opened the doors of heaven, had rained down manna on them to eat and given them the bread of heaven. Men ate angels' food. He sent them food to the full. He caused an east wind to blow in the heavens. And by his power, he brought in the south wind. He also rained meat on them like the dust, feathered fowl like the sand of the seas. And he let them fall in the midst of their camp, all around their dwellings. Brethren, my prayer is I will learn to trust God. You see, I've gotten to a point where I don't try to understand God. But whatever need I have, I know that God is more than able to meet. I don't tell him anymore how to give me money. One or two people are here. You need some money. And as far as you're concerned, it's only the lottery that can give you that kind of money. Say, God, only with these debts, with these bills, only if I win the lottery. Says who? God can do just about anything. Things that have never happened anywhere in this world. And that's one of my prayers. I pray that in this place, God will do things that he has never done anywhere else. In the name of Jesus. But we have to get to a place where we release our faith and allow God to be God. Allow God to be God. When they were complaining about meat, they wondered, they looked at all of their livestock and they said, even if we slaughter all these animals, it won't be enough for us. How can God do it? What can God do? And suddenly, quails. God sent wind and all the quails from all over the world, God brought and caused them, because they were fighting against the wind, to be weak. Caused them to flutter just around eye level. So the people simply had to reach out and catch the birds. Brethren, this God we serve, you must never second guess God. You must never say, this is how God will do it. No. You can never say, I know God. I know a bit. And Job makes us appreciate that. Job causes us to appreciate that. All of us know about God is not even up to 1% of who God is. Not up to 1% of who God is. If you look at yourself, you can't even boast and say you know yourself. And if you can't boast that you know yourself, you can't boast and say you know your wife or your husband. And then you want to boast and say you know your you don't know yourself. So who, if you don't know yourself, that you are with 24 hours a day, that you have been with for the last 70 years, you don't know yourself, and you want to say you know God, that's a bit of a laugh. Brethren, if, God forbid, one ISIS member comes in here now, let's even say 10. The first threw one grenade under one car. You hear the explosion. The sound of the explosion will cause some of you that don't even know what has happened outside. The names and the sounds that will come out of your mouth will first make us wonder if you know Jesus. And then if they come in here and then they first shoot into the roof. You hear something? Hey, what's that? Hey, save you. Hey, just the thought is enough to paralyze some people. Not to talk of if it actually happens. Let's stay with the word of God. Nobody here can tell me this is what I will do, and I will believe. Do we understand that? Because I, that I'm standing here in the office of God, representing God as the pastor, I cannot guarantee my wife or our daughter in the back what I will do. Because I have seen strange things happen and I have seen people that I thought had relationship with God fail themselves and my expectations of them. So you don't even know yourself. An example so small. Will the usher say, no, this is our job, we're here to look after the people? No. Ebenezer will say he's not married, he hasn't had children yet. Why should he die for? So it's impossible for you to say you know God and then tell God this is how we should do this matter. No, let God be God. When we release God to be God, brethren, the kinds of things that happen will cause us to constantly bow in worship, in awe. We won't be like these people. We won't be like a people that second guess God. Isaiah 55, 9, the Bible says, for as the heavens are higher than the earth, this is God speaking. He says, so are my ways higher than your ways. Higher than your ways. Your greatest height concerning your ways is nothing compared. I haven't even started there. He says, so are my ways higher than your ways. And my thoughts than your thoughts. He says, think your wildest thought about how awesome God is. He says, you're not even beginning to come anywhere close. Never second guess God. You know, there are many stories, but let's look at Ezekiel 37. Let's deal with familiar ground so we can move quickly. Ezekiel 37, I'll read the first three verses. It says, the hand of the Lord came upon me, Ezekiel speaking, and brought me out in the spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the midst of the valley, and it was full of bones. Then God caused me to pass by them all around. And behold, there were very many in the open valley, and indeed they were very dry. And God says to the prophet Ezekiel, son of man, can these bones live? And this is great wisdom. So I answered, O Lord God, you know. I said, ah, God, I know you. You can cause them to live. And what if God says, no, they won't live? You know, there's a story of an old sage that was mentoring a young fellow. And one day they were out walking and the old sage catches a butterfly in mid-flight. And he looks at his young mentee. And says, is the butterfly alive in my hand? And the mentee thinks, if I say yes, he can crush it and say you failed. If I say no, it's not alive, he can let it go. So like Ezekiel, he said, sir, you have the power of life and death in your hands. You tell me. And that's where we ought to be with God. Brethren, God, if you can't even begin to understand God. It doesn't matter how blessed your brain is. And by the way, they say the most intelligent human being doesn't use more than 10% of their brain capacity. I don't know why God gave us 100% and the most intelligent uses only 10%. You, like I said, don't know yourself. How much more God? You know, there are people that speak languages, and God understands all languages. God sees all people. There are animals we have never dreamt of, but they are alive somewhere on the face of this earth. God knows them all. There are fish in the depths of the sea. God sees all. And then you want to say you know this God. And that's just one planet. And then we're talking about galaxies. And brother, where do you want to start with God? Where do you want to start with this God that is our Father and that is mindful of us? And yet we grumble, we complain. We need to understand how to engage God, how to build relationship with God. There's a man, his name is Sid Roth, he runs some program. He talks about living the supernatural naturally. And that's who we ought to be. But we are living the natural naturally. We are functioning like mere men. My prayer is that things will change in the name of Jesus. And for things to change, our thinking has to change. We can't have Jesus as our Lord and Savior and carry on like mere mortals. Totally impossible. Our lifestyle, our thinking, the achievements God will birth through us should be a form of evangelism. People must see us and see glory. When we open our mouths to speak, it mustn't be nonsense that comes out of our mouths. You want to joke? You say, see you looking like a monkey. What kind of joke is that? I mean, you know. Let's deal with the word of God. God will help us in Jesus' name. You know, there's a story in Acts 10, 7 verses. I'll read the story real quick, and then we'll begin to bring this to an end so we can pray. Brethren, we serve an incredible God. Don't second guess God. Build your relationship. Take your relationship to the point where you hear from God where you're a friend of God, where God tells you things. There are examples in the Bible. God will come down and walk with Enoch. God said concerning Abraham, I can't hide anything from him. He said concerning David, he said, this is my boy. This is my guy. Can you imagine that? Let's read Acts 10 so we can pray. I'll read from verse 10. It says, then he became very hungry, Peter, and wanted to eat. But while they made ready, he fell into a trance and saw heaven opened and an object like a great sheet bound at the four corners descending to him and let down to the earth. In it were all kinds of four-footed animals of the earth, wild beasts, creeping things, and birds of the air. And a voice came to him, rise, Peter, kill and eat. But Peter said, not so, Lord. I mean, he's answering God. God says, do something. He says, no, God, that's not the way. Who are you to tell God that's not the way? A lady was praying, asking God for her husband. And God says, look out of the window. Daddy Gio told us a story. He knows the lady personally. She's at work, supposed to be working, but she chooses to pray, to ask God for a husband. Like a lot of you do. Instead of working, you do other things, but that's all right. God is merciful. He says, look out of the window. And she looks out, excited, expecting to see somebody driving in with a limousine and, you know, somebody looking good. And she looks. There's no one at the gate but the gate man. So she goes back to God. God, help me open my eyes. I can't see. There's nobody. She sees a gate man. She says, there's nobody there. God says, look again. She says, yes, Lord. It's just the gate man. Nobody has come yet. God says, that's your husband. There's no joy in her heart as she hears that. But to cut a long story short, the fellow is a gate man because his parents didn't have the finances to further his education. Brilliant fellow, first class brain. And that's why he's doing what he's doing. So she obviously hears from God, agrees with God, begins to speak to the gate man. Cut a long story short, she uses her funds because she was a woman that was doing very well. Sends him to school, finds out how brilliant he is. And today, I believe he's an accountant. And he's doing very well. In fact, he's doing better than her, to the glory of God the Father. So sometimes the package may not seem right. But if God is in it, you better honor God. God says, do this. You don't, like Peter, argue with God. Peter said, not so. No. God, no. God, you don't understand. Let me tell you how it is done. You tell God. So he says, not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything common or unclean. And a voice spoke to him again the second time. What God has cleansed, you must not call common. This was done three times. That's the mercy of God. God showed mercy three times. And the object was taken up into heaven again. And all three times, his position didn't change. Brethren, where you are stubborn, my prayer is that spirit of stubbornness will leave you. Amen. Where God says and you argue with God, my prayer is that today is the last time that will happen. Because this few verses cost Peter a great deal. God had to raise Paul. And that's another story. God had to raise Paul, and Paul was called the apostle to the Gentiles. Peter was supposed to be the apostle to all. But he refused to understand that even the Gentiles can be saved. He totally refused. So Paul was raised. And that's another story. How do you raise a man that was responsible for the stoning of a saint and make him the greatest apostle after Jesus? How does that work? But that's the God we serve. So your background doesn't make any difference to this God. The evil you have done, the abortions you have committed, the woman, all the evil you have done, doesn't count for anything if you will turn and face Jesus. There's a story in John chapter 4, I believe it's from like verse 5 to about verse 30, and it's the story of the woman at the well. At some point, Jesus says to her, go and call your husband. And she says, I don't have a husband. He says, you've told the truth. You've had five husbands. The one you're living with now is not even your husband. Brethren, he saw, he knew. But he sent her back as an evangelist. A woman that community ostracized. They wanted nothing to do with her. That's the woman that God used to win a whole community. Brethren, don't ever second guess God. He is bigger than us. Don't ever try to understand what God is doing. There's a story in Luke chapter 8, I believe it's from verse 25 to 39, is the story of the madman of Gadara. This man, according to Daddy Gio, madmen saw him and said, that man is mad. He was mad and mad for all to see. But God used him as an evangelist to win a whole town. A madman, a king of madmen, became an evangelist. Brethren, with God, everything is possible. Just make up your mind, follow the Holy Spirit. How he chooses, who he chooses, what he does is totally up to him. He does not owe any man any explanation. That's the God we serve. And that's the God that has said to us this month, the lines will fall unto us. In fact, he says the lines have fallen unto us in pleasant places. My prayer is that you will learn to let God be God in your situation. You will learn to hear what he's saying. We can't have Jesus as our Lord and Savior. And our thinking is common like that of common men. I don't mean any insult to the Gentiles. But if he has chosen me, then I must excel. If he has chosen me, he didn't choose me to fail. And if I am failing, it's not his fault, it is my fault. So I need to check myself. What am I doing wrong? Because if I'm serving God as I ought to serve him, my life must be such that as people hear my testimony, as people come in contact with me, they must want to know the God that I serve. Brethren, let's bow our heads, take ourselves to God, and just speak to this incredible God that we serve. This God that is more awesome than we can ever understand. This God that does things and can constantly do things that he has never done anywhere on the face of this earth. Brethren, I'm believing God that today something will change in somebody's heart. Somebody will grow hungrier for God. Somebody will learn to serve God as he ought to be served. Somebody will let God be God in their lives. Somebody will stop telling God how to bless them. But somebody will be open to the blessings of God anyhow he wants to do it. Well, let's pray for ourselves that our relationship with God will get stronger. And that's the key, relationship with God. That we will be friends of God. We will delight in him. We will hear his voice. We will please him. We don't look to man, we look to God. Brethren, we serve an incredible God. Incredible God. God is in charge of protocol so he can break protocol. All power belongs to God. He does as he pleases. Let's just take ourselves to him. I say, Father, your will be done. We refuse. Impossible as it sounds, we refuse to stand in your way. And let's pray for ourselves. Let's pray for our loved ones. We can pray here in Dublin and affect things in China. That's the power of the supernatural. Somebody will pray here this morning. And somebody in Africa will be healed. Let's pray. Somebody will cry out to God, and how he will do it, we don't know. But their matrimonial situation will change. Somebody will pray. And God will send somebody from another end of this world to be a blessing to that person. Things we cannot even begin to imagine are going to begin to happen because we're going to let this incredible God be God. Let's just commit ourselves, commit our children, commit our spouses, commit our careers, commit his church into his hands. Everything belongs to God. His will alone be done. If we dare say his worst plans for us are better than our best plans for ourselves. I say, Father, your will, your will. Many things happen we don't understand, but the Bible gives us an assurance that everything works together for good. I say, Father, your will, your will, your will, your will, your will, your will alone. Incredible God. Incredible God. Incredible God. A God that will bring water out of the rock, unimaginable. A God that will divide the Red Sea, unimaginable. A God that will send ravens to feed his son, unimaginable. A God that can make a way where there seems to be no way, unimaginable God. Oh, let's worship this God. a God that will take the doctor's report and cancel the doctor's report simply because he wants to show his power. Oh, let's take ourselves to God. Take our every situation to God. Let's thank him. Thank him for new things. Thank him for glorious things. And the things we are worried about, let's apologize to God this morning. Ask him to forgive us. Because that fear will never manifest in the physical. No. We're worried about things that will never happen. Because God has love for us. God cares about us. Those bills that haven't been paid, God is more than able. The silver and the gold belong to him. The situation that is troubling us from the past, God can go into yesterday and change things. That's the God we serve. The tomorrow that we are afraid of, God has gone ahead. I say, Father, we refuse to fear. And let us mean it as we say. We refuse to be afraid. We refuse to be threatened because we serve an incredible God. The exams that we're wondering how we will pass, we'll play our part. We will study. And God will show us mercy. Incredible God. The things that we're afraid of, they're nothing before God. That's the God that we serve. He's our Father. Father, we bless you. Father, we ask that our relationship with you will take a turn for the better. We ask for a paradigm shift in our thinking, O God. Father, we especially ask for those that don't believe in you, those that don't have Jesus as their Lord and Savior, to come to the saving knowledge of Jesus. Father, we thank you that from today things have changed. We give you praise. We give you glory. Thank you, Most High God. In Jesus' wonderful name, we have prayed. Amen. Someone say, thank you, Jesus.
And we're his portion and he's our prize. Drawn to redemption by the grace in his eyes. If his grace is an ocean, we're all.